ito pa. Noong pong August 21, 1983, and I use the phrase from Roosevelt, Day of Infamy. You will recall that the breakout of the war in the Pacific was the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor. And Roosevelt himself said, it was a day of infamy. We can also say that August 21, 1983 was a day of infamy in Philippine history. In two senses. One, ay pinatay po si Ninoy. Pagbaba po niya sa Manila International Airport, binaril po siya habang bababa sa hanggan, and he was dead on the tarmac. And it changed Philippine history. We know that. It led to the downfall of President Marcos and becoming president later on of Korea here. But the second point that I'm saying that it's a day of infamy is because on that same day, before Aquino flew to Manila, he passed by Singapore. And I was a personal witness to that incident because I was in the embassy in Bangkok with our ambassador then, General Rafael Aleppo, ambassador to Thailand. His job then was to monitor the movement of Ninoy while coming to Manila. And he told me in his office that, Consul, I know Ninoy is now in Singapore and he is motoring to Malaysia. In other words, he just used Singapore as a route to Malaysia. And then, of course, the question arises, why is he in Malaysia? I had no answer at that time, until very much later. And the answer was, Ninoy needed all the support he can get to oust Marcos. And a logical person to do that for him is the Prime Minister of Malaysia, Mohammad Mahathir. And now we know that there was a commitment from Mahathir to help oust Marcos, his old enemy on the Sabah issue, when Ninoy comes to power. And in my view, that is the origin of why the government today of Pinoy is somehow at, reluctant. What is the explanation why this government appears so so inutile? The overwhelming impression is what's holding back our president, what's holding back our government to rescue our own citizens dying in the palm fields of Malaysia. And the answer lies on what happened on that day, on August 21, 1983. In other words, we can speculate that if there was no commitment in 1983 and Korea did not become president, there would have been no commitment. All right? So that is the thesis that I want to bring to you today. That our hands are tied today because the leadership, not only at that time, but up to this day, is committed to drop the Philippine claim to Sabbath. And what is the clearest proof of this? The clearest proof is found in our Constitution. The 1987 Constitution, Article 1 on National Territory, is an amendment to the 1973 Marcos Constitution. And if you compare the two, now, there are 14 words omitted in the 73 Article 1. And what are those words? Well, I wrote it in the paper. The 14 words says that the other territories belonging to the Philippines by historic right and legal title was deleted. I'm sorry, Sultan. I'm sorry for the Karam family. That the claim to Sabah enshrined in the 73 Constitution, the Marcos Constitution, was totally deleted from the 1987 Constitution. Why did that happen? What was the reason for dropping it? Was it magic? Well, it's because of the 1983 commitment. Cory made sure, and Mahathir made sure, that 14 words be deleted from Article 1. And when that happened, that is the origin of our troubles today. You see, I couldn't say that when I was in the Department of Foreign Affairs. But you know, I worked for 3 years on this problem, not only of Sabah, but the entire archipelagic state. You will recall that in 1982, the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea was finally adopted after 10 years of negotiations, the longest ever in the United Nations. It's a very big treaty published in a book of about 300 pages. You can imagine how complex the treaty is. But the Philippines benefited from this convention. Why? The United Nations finally recognized the existence of archipelagic states. What are archipelagic states? As defined in Part 4 of the Convention. Well, they said, archipelagic states are those states or countries made up of archipelagos. In other words, there may be one or more archipelagos. Okay? It can also include islands separate from the archipelagos. They can also include parts of islands. Sir, you will agree that Sabah is part of the island of Borneo. Therefore, it can belong to an archipelagic state like the Philippines. So you see that in 1982, the United Nations has delivered to us the unprecedented opportunity to apply international law to our claims, including that of Sabah. That is 1982. But in 1987, we squandered the opportunity. We amended our constitution precisely opposed, contrary to what international law has provided. In UNCLOS, how would you explain this kind of administrative or political behavior? There must be very strong lobby somewhere comparison is right at the top. So we, like me, a small-time bureaucrat, applying the convention how to maximize the Philippine claim, came up with our own proposals. And we did. I was going to show in a map today. What is the real configuration of the Philippine archipelagic state and how to include Sabah in accordance with part 4 of the convention. But our efforts were in vain. In fact, I'm sad to say, to admit, I was removed from my position in 2003 for espousing views different from the management.